Hello students. So today I shall cover the last part of the gear chapter. So I shall cover today the helical gear, bevel gear, few part of the worm gear, and like most of the important thing, the gear train. Okay. So helical gear, I have already told you the helical gears are used to connect to parallel shaft. So helical gear has teeth in form of helix, around the gear. Okay. So helical gears may be used to connect to parallel shafts. The helices may be right-handed to one gear and left-handed to another gear. Okay. So helical gears give the smooth drive with high efficiency of transmission. Helical gears are single helical type or double helical type. So in case of single helical gear, there is some axial thrust that exists in between the tip. So that is the disadvantage. So in order to eliminate the axial thrust, double helical gears are used. So double helical gears are often also called the herringbone gears. It is equivalent to two single helical gears in which equal and opposite thrust are provided on each gear, and the resulting axial thrust becomes zero. That means the two equal and opposite thrust balance each other, hence the net resultant axial thrust becomes zero. So it is good to use the double helical gear. Okay, just go through these particular points. Now, what are the different terms used in helical gears? So, this is all helicals. Okay, this is the helix angle that is denoted by alpha. Here you see this is a PC, that is the circular pitch. Now, helix angle, what is helix angle? So, it is a constant angle made by helices with the axis of rotation. So, this is the helix and this is the axis of rotation. So the angle in between two is the helix angle. Now axial pitch, it is the distance parallel to the axis between similar faces of adjacent teeth. It is denoted by PC. It is nothing but what is, we have used in spar gear, the circular pitch. It is helical gear, it is called the axial pitch. Okay. So normal pitch, so it is a distance between. So here we see this is the PN. Okay, normal pitch, this is a circular pitch. So normal pitch is a distance between similar faces of adjacent teeth along helix on the pitch cylinders normal to the teeth. Okay, normal to the teeth. So this is along the helix and normal to the teeth. So this is denoted by PN. So here we see PN equal to PC cos alpha. Okay. You can geometrically establish this relation PN equal to PC cos alpha. Okay. Now remember this point. In single helical gear, the helix angle is from 20 to 35 degree, while for double helical gear, it may be up to 45 degree. Okay. This point is important for objective questions. Now, equivalent number of teeth for helical gear. The equivalent number of teeth for helical gear may be defined as number of teeth that can be generated on the surface of a cylinder having radius equal to the radius of curvature of a point at the tip of minor axis of the ellipse obtained by taking a section of the gear in the normal plane. So all these sentences are basically assumed based on the geometrical interpretations. So mathematically the relation is TE, that means the equivalent number of teeth, TE, equivalent number of teeth, or it is also called formative number of teeth. Okay, so T equal to T by cos cube alpha, that means T equal to T sec cube alpha. Okay, remember this relation where T is the actual number of teeth on the helical gear and alpha is the helix angle. Now come to the bevel gear. So bevel gears are used for transmitting power at a constant velocity ratio between two shafts whose axis intersect as at a certain angle. Okay, that means in the bevel gear, the axis of the shaft shall not be parallel. Okay, these two shafts shall be intersecting time. So that's two shaft in these two shafts intersect certain angle. Okay, the classification, when the, you know, I have already told you meter gear. So meter gear is nothing but when two equal bevel gears. Equal bevel gear means having equal number of teeth, that means dia will be equal, connect two shafts whose axis intersect at a right angle. So they are called the meter gear. Now angular bevel gear, when the bevel gears connect to shaft whose axis intersect at an angle other than right angle, they are called the angular bevel gear. When intersect at right angle, it is called meter gear. When intersect other than 90 degree, then it is called angular bevel gear. Now, crown bevel gear. So, when the bevel gears connect to shafts whose axis intersect at an angle greater than right angle, greater than 90 degree, and one of the bevel gears has a pitch angle of 90 degree, this is known as crown bevel gear. Okay. Now, terms. So, face angle. So, face angle is denoted by phi. Face angle is the pitch angle plus addendum angle. Okay. Root angle. Root angle is denoted by theta r. It is denoted by pitch angle minus addendum angle. Okay. Just go through the definitions and must remember. Okay. Now, bevel factor. If B denotes the face width, L denotes the cone distance, then the bevel factor is written by L minus B by L. Okay. Now, formative or equivalent number of teeth. As formative number of teeth, I have already told you in case of helical gear, T equal to T by cos cube alpha. Here it is T equal to T by cos theta. Okay. Now, let's come worm gear. So, worm gears are basically used for transmitting power at high velocity ratio between non-intersecting shaft that are generally but not necessarily at right angles. It can give velocity ratio as high as 300:1. So worm gear, you know, worm gear is a type of spiral gear or skew bevel gear. In the first lecture of the gear class, I have already told you the skew bevel gear or spiral gear, in which two shaft must be non-intersecting type, non-parallel type, and non-coplanar type. Okay, so worm gear is a type of this, which is skew bevel gear or spiral gear. Now, worm gears are basically used for high velocity ratio transmissions, like 300:1. So, it is the most advantage part of the worm gear. The power transmission is having the high velocity ratio. Okay. Now, look at this picture. This is a helical gear, two parallel shafts. Okay, this is basically single helical gear. The helix is basically on the single plane. Okay, now here we see the double helical gear. In this plane, you see the right handed helix and left handed helix. Okay, so this is the bevel gear you see. This is the skew bevel gear or spiral gear. This is a meter gear. So, meter gear is a type of bevel gear, okay, in which you see the axis of the two shafts are 90 degree and number of teeth of these two wheels are equal, okay. Now, this is a worm gear. In worm gear, also you see the axis of the two shafts are perpendicular, okay. So, these are all different types of gears. Now, gear train. Sometimes two or more gears are made to mesh with each other to transmit power from one shaft to another shaft. In combination is called the gear train. Okay. Now, gear trains are classified mainly four categories: simple gear train, compound gear train, reverted, and epicyclic. Now, simple gear train. So, simple gear train means nothing but in one shaft there will be one gear only. Okay. So, here you see gear number 1, gear number 2. Gear number 1 is larger in size and gear number 2 is smaller in size. You can say that gear 1 drives the gear 2. So, gear 1 can be called as the driver and gear 2 can be called as the follower or driven. So, speed ratio or velocity ratio means the speed of the driver divided by speed of the driven. Okay. So, N1 by N2. N1 by N2 means T2 by T1. You know. Okay. How where from it is coming, you know that is m equal to d by t module. That means when module is constant, d is directly proportional to t. Once again, we know v equal to pi dn by 60. That means d is inversely proportional to n. That means d is directly proportional to t and inversely proportional to n. So, you can say here N1 by N2 equal to T2 by T1. That is as per gear definition, gear terms you know in the first class, I have already covered this. Okay. So, T1, T2 are the nothing but the T in the driver and driven part respectively. So, train value is nothing but the reciprocal of the speed ratio. So, it is the N2 by N1 or T2 equal to T1 by T2. Now, compound gear train is nothing but when in one shaft there will be more than one gear. So, it is called compound. Okay. Here we see in the one shaft, you can see there is two shafts. In the next shaft, you see there are two shafts, 4 and 5. Okay. So, first one is the driver. Gear number 1 is the driver. It drives the gear 2. Okay. Once again, gear 2 and 3 are in the same shaft. Okay, so gear number 2 and gear number 3 will rotate in the same velocity. Now, gear 3 will rotate the gear 4, will drive the gear 4. And when gear 4 rotates, gear 5 is also in the same shaft, so it will start rotating. And in gear 5, start driving the gear 6. So, first driver is the gear 1, second driven is the gear 6. I mean, the last driven is the gear 6. So, first driver is the gear 1, last driver driven is the gear 6. So, here we see as gear number 1 and 2 messes with each other. So, we can see N1 by N2 equal to T2 by T1. Also, we see gear 3 and gear 4 will mess each other. So, N3 by N4 equal to T4 by T3. Also, we see gear 5 and gear 6 will mess each other. So, N5 by N6, N6 equal to T6 by T5. Now we'll multiply above three equations, we'll get this relation. And we can note that the N1, gear number 2 and gear number 3 are in the same shaft. Gear 4 and 5 are in the same shaft. So here we see that N2 by N3, N5 by N6, okay, all are 1, so they will be deducted. So like this, we get the expression by N1 by N6. So N1 by N6 is nothing but it's a speed ratio or velocity ratio. So that is equal to product of number of teeth in the driven side, product of number of teeth in the driver side. Okay, T2, T4, T6. These two are the driven followers. So T2, T4, T6. These two are the followers. So number of teeth in the follower side, product of number of teeth in the follower side divided by product of number of teeth in the driver side. Okay. So train value is the reciprocal of speed value. Now advantage of the compound gear train from a simple gear train is that much larger speed reduction is possible from the first shaft to the last shaft, and that can be obtained in the small gears. Okay. Now reverted gear train, that means the first driver and the last driven will be in the same shaft. That is, it's called the reverted gear train. Here we see the gear 1 drives gear 2. Gear 2 and gear 3 on the same shaft, and gear 3 drives the gear 4. Here we see that gear 1 and gear 4 are in the same shaft, coaxial shaft. So this is called the reverted gear train. So gear 1 and gear 2 messes with each other. So N1 by N2 equal to T2 by T1. Similarly, N3 by N4 equal to T4 by T3. Multiply these two equations, we will get this relation. That means speed ratio N1 by N4 equal to product of number of teeth in the driven divided by product of number of teeth in the driver side. Okay. So reverted gear trains are basically used in automotive transmission, laid back gears, industrial speed reducers, and in clock, where minute and right hand, hour hand shafts are coaxial. Okay. The examples of applications are very much important, must go through. Okay. The epicyclic gear train. Here we see there is arm. See, that arm is also rotating. Okay. So in this gear train, the axis of the shaft over which the gears are mounted may move relative to the fixed axis. In our figure, gear A and gear B, gear A and arm C have a common axis 1. Okay, gear A and arm C has a common axis 1, about which they can rotate. The gear B messes with gear A and has its own axis at the arm O2. About the gear can rotate. If the arm is fixed, the gear train is simple. Arm is fixed, that means gear A can drive gear B, there is no issue. But when the arm starts rotating, that particular structure is called the epicyclic motion, and this structure is called the epicyclic gear train. Okay, when arm starts rotating in the gear, epicyclic gear train, it is very much simple saying that arm start rotate, and that simple configuration will be called that the epicyclic motion, and the configuration must be called the epicyclic gear train. So epicyclic gear trains are useful for transmitting the high velocity ratio with gears of moderate size in a comparatively lesser space. Epicyclic gear trains are used in the back gears of lathe, differential gears, automobile, hoist, pulley, blocks, wristwatches. Okay, just go through these applications. Okay, now if you have any problem, ask me. Okay, thank you.